Welcome, everybody, to the International Spy Museum. I am Mark Stout. I'm the former historian of the International Spy Museum. The current museum historian, Dr. Vince Houghton, is away out of town on a secret mission, which perhaps you will hear about in the future. But I'm always delighted to come back to my old haunts and step in whenever necessary. You've come tonight to what I think is going to be a wonderful program that we are putting on in cooperation with the Norwegian Embassy, because this is the story we're going to be hearing tonight is about a World War II, very important and famous and dramatic, as you will hear, World War II raid into Norway conducted primarily by Norwegians. It was an obvious thing to partner up with the Norwegian Embassy. So I'd just like to say a few words by way of introduction to our friends here from the Norwegian Embassy, specifically Jun Oslebo, who is here, who's Minister Counselor for Communications, Cultural Affairs, and Education at the Royal Norwegian Embassy. He's been here serving in Washington for about 10 months on this particular tour. He served here previously, a decade or so ago, I believe. His immediately preceding tour was in Oslo at the Foreign Ministry, where he's been a number of times, but he's also served in good diplomatic fashion in countries as varied as Mozambique, Poland, Switzerland, and Morocco. Jun and indeed the entire Norwegian Embassy are good friends of the International Spy Museum. We've done a number of really fun and interesting events over the years with them. We are delighted to work with them again tonight and to have them here. So perhaps a few words from our Norwegian friends.
Good evening, everyone. And we are certainly delighted to work with the Spy Museum. Thank you for hosting this interesting program. We're going to hear about an event that is certainly part of the history of my own country, and I'm quite happy that it does not take a bigger part in shaping the world's history, because that might have been devastating. So the embassy is pleased to be a partner. Just a few days ago, Norway celebrated the 71st anniversary of the surrender of the Nazi occupying forces of the Second World War. Now, 71 years is a long time. It's long enough for people to forget. It's long enough for new generations never to learn what happened, and not to speak of reflecting on the significance of what happened. Historians know that they should never ask hypothetical questions. What would have happened if? They're supposed to focus on fact and explain what led to a certain outcome. But in the case of the heavy water operation at Vemork in Norway, it is a little bit tempting to speculate what would our societies have looked like if the Nazis had succeeded in their ambitions to produce an atomic bomb. In the interior of Telemark County in Norway, the Germans were producing a key ingredient to such a bomb, and some of the production is here in the room. I'm sure you will hear about that later. Two initial attempts to stop the production failed, and 41 young commandos lost their lives as a result. The third attempt, however, was successful, and we all look forward to hearing Neal Bascomb talk about it. In particular, I know that there is a young man sitting right here. Odin is 7 years old, and he's here because his grandmother's brother was the last of the commandos to leave the plant after they planted the bomb. Fredrik Kaiser, he was one of the commandos at Vemork, and he is no longer alive, I understand, but it's part of their family history. So thank you, and I look forward to listening to Neal Bascomb's presentation.
So a few words about Neal before we get started. Neal is a New York Times best-selling and award-winning author of quite a number of books, all nonfiction, which tend to focus on inspiring stories of adventure or achievement. Neal studied economics and English literature, an interesting combination, at Miami University in Ohio, and then worked as a journalist in Europe for a number of years, and then later as an editor at the St. Martin's Press in New York. And he now makes his living writing books, which makes him a rare individual. And he has been very successful in this endeavor. His first book was Higher, A Historic Race to the Sky and the Making of a City, a book about New York City. And that was selected for the Barnes & Noble Discover Great New Writers Award and was featured on a History Channel documentary. He then wrote a book called The Perfect Mile about Roger Bannister and the ultimately successful effort to break the four-minute mile. His third book was Red Mutiny, about the 1905 mutiny on the battleship Potemkin in the late days of Tsarist Russia. His fourth book, which I believe you can buy back there alongside The Winter Fortress, was Hunting Eichmann, about Israeli intelligence's mission to find Adolf Eichmann and bring him to Israel. Put in modern terms, it's a story about a rendition. And that's what it was. And this book was so successful that a young adult edition called Nazi Hunters was also put out and won a number of awards as well. Neal's work has been translated into something like 15 languages, featured in several documentaries, and optioned for film and television projects. Neal is among the fortunate few who not only is able to make his living as a writer, but also gets to live in Seattle, Washington. As you might imagine from somebody who lives in Seattle, he is an avid hiker, skier, and coffee drinker. And as a Seattle resident, as I once was, he is therefore definitionally a good guy, and we're very glad to have him. Neal Bascomb.
I want to thank the International Spy Museum and the Norwegian Embassy for co-sponsoring this event, and thank you all for coming this evening. Now, last week I was driving in Seattle, and I was listening to NPR, and I was listening to this interview of Chris Anderson, who runs the TED Talks. And over the course of the interview, I was listening avidly because I was about to go on book tour, and Chris said that the longest you can possibly maintain an audience's attention is 18 minutes. You guys will be here for roughly 2.5 hours. So hold tight. Now, as Mark introduced, I've written quite a few different kinds of books. Skyscrapers and 4 Minute Miles and Tsarist Russia, High School Kids Building Robots. And people often ask me, you know, What's going on here? What's the theme? Why all this disparate kinds of books? Now, my wife says, I think ungenerously, that I choose my books based on where I want to travel next. Now, Norway's a lovely place to travel, so that may be slightly accurate. But I choose my books, I focus on stories. And this may be somewhat of a cliche, but it's the kind of stories that grab me, stories about ordinary people doing extraordinary things. And this story of the atomic sabotage by Norwegians definitely classifies within that. Now, this is a story about atomic sabotage, about atomic physics, about heavy water. It has some heavy stuff in it. But I don't want to lose sight, and I don't want you to lose sight of what is important in this story. And I'd like to read a letter that Leif Tronstad here, who was a scientist, Norwegian scientist, chemist, who basically orchestrated all of these sabotages and devoted the rest of his life towards it. He was in London, escaped Norway, went to London, worked with the British. And he wrote this series of letters to his family, who was still back in Norway, many of them to his young daughter, Sidsel. His son, Leif, was too young to read. But in one of these, written in 1943, he tried to explain to Sidsel why he was away, because she was very upset. And I'd like to read it here, a part of it here tonight. "We have to do everything for our land to make it free again. When we say our fatherland, we don't just mean the land, which is beautiful and we also love, but also everything else we love at home, mother, little boy, and you, and all the other fathers and mothers and children. I also mean all the wonderful memories from the time we ourselves were small, and from later when we had children of our own, our home villages with the hills and mountains and forests, the lakes and ponds and rivers and streams and waterfalls and fjords. The smell of new hay in summer, of birches in spring, of the sea and the big forest, and even the biting winter cold. Everything. Norwegian songs and music and so much, much more. That's our fatherland. That's what we have to struggle to get back. That's why I'm here. Now let's turn to atomic physics. You guys are all very excited, I can see. But I think it's important to describe what heavy water is, why it is important. And I'll do this in a very basic way because that's how my understanding of it is. You have regular H2O, you have water, okay, which you can drink. It has hydrogen. Hydrogen has a single electron and a single proton. Heavy water, D2O, deuterium, it's a variant or what's called an isotope of hydrogen. It actually has a neutron within the nucleus, makes it heavier. You can see it here. Now, why that's important is, in the course of the war, the Germans and the Americans were attempting to build heavy water reactors, self-sustaining nuclear reactors. And they needed a moderator, okay, a heavy water or graphite, where you have these neutrons flinging around within this reactor, and you need to slow them down to foster the fission. And the thing that H2O does, if you have these neutrons flinging around, it might slow them down, but it absorbs those flinging around neutrons, stealing them away from a potential chain reaction. D2O, heavy water, doesn't absorb them. They bombard, they slow, and the neutrons move on. This fosters the chain reaction. Now, these heavy water reactors, the idea, and the Germans knew this and the Americans knew this by 1942, is if you have a heavy water reactor, it will breed plutonium. And if you have plutonium, you have the basics for an atomic bomb. This is the atomic bomb explosion over Nagasaki. This was a plutonium bomb. Now, when many people talk about the German atomic bomb program, they talk about Werner Heisenberg, this gentleman on the far left. At the start of the war, the Americans and Germans were basically at the same place. They both knew, after the first splitting of the atom, that the potential for atomic power or an atomic weapon was very viable. So they both moved forward on programs. Heisenberg was part of that program. He was a genius. He was a theoretical physicist. He had won the Nobel Prize in his early 30s. But he wasn't the key man of the German atomic bomb program. The gentleman on your far right was Dr. Kurt Diebner. He worked in the Army Ordnance Department. And for years, through the mid-30s, he was telling his bosses, we should focus on atomic physics. It's the future. And his bosses kept coming back to him and saying, stop with this, quote unquote, atomic malarkey. And so he didn't move forward. And then the splitting of the atom happened. And suddenly, Kurt Diebner was elevated into the role as the head of the German Uranium Club. He starts basic research. Heisenberg provides a lot of it. But Diebner is the one in charge. He's part of the Nazi party. He very much wants an atomic bomb. Now, one of the key things he needs, and the reason we're here tonight, is heavy water. And there was a single plant in all the world that produced it in any quantity, a place called Vemork. It's located about 100 miles west of Oslo. It's set on the edge of this ice-bound precipice. It's on the edge of a place of about 3,500 square miles called the Vida, which is this plateau of ice and rock, and most often snow. Now, it's very hard to make heavy water. They were doing it with electrolysis, so you need a lot of free or cheap hydroelectric power. And Vemork was a hydroelectric plant that also produced hydrogen for fertilizer. It was the perfect place to build a heavy water factory. Norsk Hydro, the Norwegian industrial concern, was the one who financed it, built it. And in 1940, the Germans came calling. We want all your heavy water, as much as you can give us. And Norsk Hydro, the head of Norsk Hydro, said, well, what do you need that for? And the Germans, Kurt Diebner and his engineers that he sent, said, well, we can't tell you. No heavy water for the Germans. Until the spring of 1940, when the Germans occupied Norway rather quickly. They went to Vemork. Diebner sent his engineers and his scientists and told them to ramp up production, first twofold, then fivefold, then tenfold. As much heavy water as could be produced, they wanted. Now, the problem for Dr. Kurt Diebner in his plans on building out the heavy water plant and getting as much as possible, he needed what he said was 5 tons for his self-sustaining reactors. I will introduce Leif Tronstadt now. Now, Tronstadt, just as a little background, Tronstadt was raised by a single mother and several siblings. He was very smart. They didn't have much money. He pulled himself up in the American way by his bootstraps. Studied in Germany, studied in England, was very well regarded as a student, came back, and was ready to start his life with his childhood sweetheart, whose name was Basse. Now, Tronstadt asked Basse at this point in time, in his early 30s, I can do one of two things, and you need to help me decide. I can be a teacher, which is what I love to do, or I can make as much money as you want me to make. I can work for industry, and we can be quite wealthy. And Basse said, I want you to be a teacher. And he became an exceptional teacher. But Leif Tronstadt, as you'll get to know over the course of this talk, was a very vigorous man. He couldn't sit still. He was constantly working, constantly doing. And so he turns out to make a lot of money, too. And he did that by consulting with these industrial concerns. In the mid-30s, he decided that heavy water had recently been discovered. No one was able to produce it in any quantity. He had this hydroelectric plant and this hydrogen factory. Wouldn't it be great if we see if we can build something that produces it in great quantity? And he does it. And it is a financial and utter economic disaster for Norsk Hydro. Nobody wants it. Nobody's interested. Of course, until the splitting of the atom, until people realize what its worth is. Now, Tronstadt's ambition with it was just as a pure science, just to see if it could be done. As he said, first experiment, practical application later. I'm not sure how Norsk Hydro felt about that. They used to joke at Norsk Hydro that heavy water was its most useful property would be to make skating rinks, because it froze at a slightly higher temperature. The Germans invade, and Leif Tronstadt goes underground, and he starts spying on the Germans, what they're doing. And in particular, he starts spying on Vemork and the increase in production and why they're doing it. The Gestapo discovers what he's doing. He's up in Trondheim. He hears they're coming for him. He escapes by train to Oslo. Puts his family up at his childhood home, skis across the border to Sweden, goes to London, and quite quickly, although the British scientific community said, Tronstadt, what we want you to do is develop scientific technology for us. And what Tronstadt said was, I want to fight. I want to fight for my country. Now, the reason I know this is because I was able, thanks to Leif's son, to assemble the diaries that Leif wrote from the time he got on that train, the first entry is on that train when he's going down to Oslo, to the moment of his death, daily entries on what he was thinking, feeling, doing. And he wanted to fight. And he quickly became and found himself at the nexus of the Norwegian High Command, which was now exiled. The Norwegian government was exiled in Britain. Here he is in his uniform. He's at the nexus of the High Command and the British SOE, the Special Operations Executive, as many of you, some of you may know, is called, I think most famously, the Ministry of Ungentlemanly Warfare. They are the commandos. They are the ones who go behind enemy lines and perform operations. So that is Tronstadt's role, and high on his list is attacking Vemork. He partners up with a man named Colonel Wilson. He was the head of the British SOE in Norway, and they start hashing up plans to go after Vemork. Now, this is by about April of 1942. And by April of 1942, the Allies are advancing in their atomic research. They're realizing, of course, that this is possible, this can happen. And they also realize that with the German science, they will also be in the same place. And they know now that heavy water is critical, and they also know it will be used in a breeder reaction, potentially for plutonium. And this is one of my favorite letters in this story because it's so bland, but it really is the impetus for all that happens afterwards. It was written April 23rd, 1942 by the scientists of the Tube Alloys Committee, the British Atomic Program. And they write to Churchill, "Since experiments have confirmed that element 94, that's plutonium, would be good for military purposes, and since this element is best prepared in systems involving the use of heavy water, the committee recommends that attempt should, if possible, be made to stop Norsk Hydro production." Summer 1942, Churchill and Roosevelt, looking rather cheery here, sit down in Hyde Park and discuss two things. One, the invasion of mainland Europe, and two, what to do about the atomic bomb program. It is here where the first discussions move forward that the Americans will take over and the British will advise. But this is the beginning of the Manhattan Project. Now, at this very meeting, they discussed the heavy water and they discussed what was happening at Vemork. And Churchill writes in his memoirs of this eerie, sinister term named heavy water. And what is decided by the summer of 1942 by Churchill is, we need to hit it. We need to do whatever we can to hit it. And the mission is on. Einar Schinnerland is really, if the British had a secret weapon in Tronstadt had a secret weapon in Einar. Einar was born on beside the dam at Lake Moss, which provided the water to the hydroelectric plant. This is a place where it's snowbound about 6 months of the year. It's a place where being self-reliant is a necessity. If something is broken, you fix it. Einar boasts that he was born with skis on his feet. He was an expert skier, an expert hunter. He was a winter survivalist. And he was an engineer who worked for Norsk Hydro. Now here's Einar. This is the cheeriest picture I could find of Einar. He looks very happy. And I love this picture because if I identify one thing with Einar Schinnerland, it's toughness. Something very different from the face you see here. But he was probably the toughest person I read about researched over the course of this story. He wanted to fight when the Germans came and occupied his village. And so one day, he goes to his mother and says, well, I'm going to go on a skiing trip. I'm going to go up into the mountains. I have my rifle. I'm on my own. And I'm going to go hunting reindeer. I will see you in 3 weeks. Instead of going north, Einar goes southwest to the coast. On his way, he crashes while skiing. I don't know how that happened. He didn't record it. And he hurts his knee badly. But he reaches the coast, he joins together with a couple other guys, and they have this ambition to hijack a steamer by gunboat and steam it across the North Sea and reach Scotland. It's a decent plan. The problem is Einar's knee is worse and worse and worse. He's injured terribly. And so he goes to the doctor, he goes to a hospital and says, I need surgery on this knee. Will you perform it today? And they say, we will. Say, well, you'll need a week or two to recover, you know, the anesthesia, the surgery. And Einar says, today, now, no anesthetic. And so Einar writes of this experience of the pain of holding the sides of the hospital bed, the worst pain he had experienced. But he had the surgery. Not 24 hours later, he was on that steamer in command of the ship with another couple of other gentlemen. They steamed it across. They reached Scotland. And Einar's thinking this whole time, well, you know, I'm going to be trained to fight over the course of 3 months or 6 months, and I'm going to become a trained soldier, and then I'll be able to fight. Well, Leif Tronstadt hears that there's this young man from Rjukan, from the Rjukan area, which is where Vemork is located, who's in town. And so Tronstadt sends the man to get Einar on a train directly to London, brings Einar into his office, and says, you're leaving in a week. You are going to be my spy on the ground. You're going to provide information to me on the plant. And Einar, of course, says, yes, this cheery man. He gets 1 week of training, 1 week of parachute training mixed with wireless radio training. And then Einar is on a Halifax bomber cruising across the North Sea, then over Norway. There's a hole in the bottom of the plane that he's going to jump through. And now the trouble is that Einar is afraid of heights. And tough as he is, you know, I love history because there's some books written on this, and every book written on it, there's Einar in the plane, and he like hurls himself through that hole. Well, the reports, the British keep everything. I love the British. The British keep dispatch reports of drop operations. And the dispatcher writes of basically having to, you know, shove Einar through the hole to get him down. But Einar jumps down, lands on that bum knee, skis home. Hello, mother. Back from my skiing vacation. And he begins to spy on Vemork. He begins to live this double life. And I can't say this with 100% accuracy, but Einar was a spy on the ground for the SOE for over 3 years, probably one of the longest standing SOE spies. And he provided an absolute wealth of information. He provided guard rotations. He provided production quotas. He provided what locks were on the door, where the stairwells were, everything you would need to know. In fact, they would joke that they had so much information on Vemork, they could build it themselves in Britain. That's what Einar and the people who helped him produced for Leif Tronstadt. But what to do about it? What operation? How do we destroy Vemork? How do we perform what Churchill and Roosevelt want us to do? Now, the Allies, particularly the Americans, maybe this is an American thing, they want to go the fast course. They want to bomb it, just destroy it from the air. Leif Tronstadt hears this plan, and he says no. And he says no for two reasons. One, there are a lot of civilians that live around that area. Norsk Hydro, it's a Norsk Hydro town, Rjukan. There's over 5,000 people living there. Any bombing operation is going to kill a number of civilians. And two, this plant is tens and tens of thousands of pounds of concrete, stone, steel, and the heavy water facility is in the basement. Now, Tronstadt said you could bomb that thing day and night, and you're not going to touch that heavy water plant. And so the Allies back off that plan. And Tronstadt says, well, what I think we should do is send in some Norwegians who know the country, send a small team, and we'll handle it. And no offense. But the British did not trust the Norwegians to do it. properly. They just didn't have the experience at that point, they thought, to perform such an operation. So they decide something else. They decide to send two teams of British Royal Engineers, sappers, parachutists, to go into this area, land by glider plane. Okay? The Halifax would tow two glider planes across the North Sea. They would release them over the drop site. They would float down and land in this welcome countryside called the Vita. Now, Tronstad is informing to them that this, you know, we should talk about this, and, you know, this is a hard place to land and a hard place to be. I'll give you an idea of how little the British knew of this area. This operation was scheduled to happen in likely November of 1942. And there's this series of correspondence, legitimate correspondence, talking about how we're going to provide the Royal Engineers with bicycles. The idea was there would be bicycles on the glider plane. They would take them out, and they would bike down to the plant in late November, which is probably a pretty bad idea given it's likely snowbound. Now, this operation was called Operation Freshman. It was called Operation Freshman because gliders had never been used by the Allies in combat operations before. Operation Freshman. Now, Tronstad did manage to have a four-man team led by Paulsen up here at the top, a four-man Norwegian team. These were Norwegians, young Norwegians, much like Schinnerland, who itched to fight, took whatever fishing vessels, some went around the world to reach Britain to be trained. The select of the select were chosen to be part of the Norwegian Independent Company, which was a SOE-run group of Norwegians who they trained, first basic training, then commando training, and basically then spy training. The idea was Paulsen, this Operation Grouse, would land. They landed in October 19th, 1942. They landed in the area. They skied. Now I say they skied. They had so much equipment that to go the number of miles they needed to go, they would ski a distance of 6 or 7 miles, stop, drop their bags, go back 6 or 7 miles, pick up the second half of their bags, and ski back again over the course of over roughly 10 days to reach the landing site. They were on the ground, they were preparing it, they were setting up what was called their Eureka Rebecca beacon, which was this, long story short, a homing device for the planes to be able to spot the landing site. Now, I don't want to forget the Royal Engineers, because these were very brave young men who were told very little of what they were getting into. They were told simply that this was an important operation. They were not told they were going to Norway, but they were told it was important enough that it could decide the fate of the war. They were asked, who wants to participate? Every man in the company stepped forward. Mid-November 1942, Operation Freshman begins. This is the horse glider that you see there. The glider pilots called the horse a glider. They nicknamed it the wooden coffin. Being inside of it was, as they described, like being inside of a, or being on top of a bucking bronco or riding a roller coaster. It was made of wood. It had a corrugated steel floor because there was so much vomit. They had harnesses, but they did very little. And they were on this on a mission across the North Sea, the furthest that any gliders had ever been towed. And the idea, again, was to land and then commence the operation. It did not go as planned. Knut Haugland, the radio operator for Operation Grouse, sent a transmission early that morning saying, all the weather is clear. By the evening, when these planes finally arrived in the dark, The cloud cover had lowered, the wind had picked up, the cold had deepened, and it was a very different place. What we do know is that the first glider, the tow rope snapped. The first glider, glider A, it was called, crashed into a mountainside. The second Halifax glider pair, we're not exactly sure what happened. What we do know is that they separated, the other glider crashed into a hillside. What we suspect is the Halifax circled around to see where the glider had landed. It too crashed. Those who were not killed on impact were captured by the Germans. Some of them were tortured, interrogated, and then, sadly, killed. Beside the loss of life, the 41 men, the Germans now know the Allies are coming. If they suspected it before, they knew now. Vemork was already a natural force set on the edge of this precipice in this very deep valley, but now it became even more so. They doubled the security, they doubled the number of guards, they increased the minefields, they fortified the single-lane suspension bridge. Any subsequent operation against Vemork would be what the Germans thought was impossible. Not within 24 hours of the catastrophe of Operation Freshman, Leif Tronstadt and Colonel Wilson went to Combined Operations, which was in charge of Operation Freshman, and said, we would like to take over this mission. Let us do our jobs. And they, in many ways, sort of washed their hands of it. They said, please. It had been such a disaster. And so Tronstadt decides, this is what we're going to do with Wilson. We are going to send a six-man team, Operation Gunnerside. This is five. I can count. We will send a six-man team. They will drop into the area, into the Vida. They will connect up with Operation Grouse. Together, they will move towards the plant and destroy it. Now, while Operation Freshman, the idea was to both hit the heavy water facility in the basement, but also to eliminate some other parts of the plant, this operation was solely focused on destroying the basement level heavy water plant. It was led by the young Joachim Runnenberg, there on the bottom, your right. Young man, no combat experience. His second in command was Knut Haukelid. Now, Knut Haukelid, his nickname, this tells you everything you need to know about Haukelid. His nickname was Bonzo. He was actually born in Brooklyn, returned to Norway when he was a young child. He was a bit of a rascal. When the Germans invaded, he fought in the Battle of Norway. He went underground, and then, like many others, found his way to England to be trained. This six-man team led by Runnenberg, who, although he didn't have combat experience, he was, as all his reports, and again, I had all the reports that the British have during the training of these men, he was, as they said, a natural leader, cunning. The men follow him without question. He became so good at these training operations that they were doing in Scotland that he then became in charge of them and led the Norwegians, many of them, most of them older than he was, on these missions. So now Operation Gunnerside is moving forward. They are now training on the mock plant that Tronstadt sets up. They are preparing sleeping bags and rations and every guns and everything they need for this operation. Runnenberg was very intensive about preparations. There's a number of reasons why things delayed for over the course of 2 months, mostly the weather. The weather over the North Sea and in Norway in December, January is not so nice. And so a dropping operation was delayed one after the next. They finally, at one point, are on a plane going there. They're going across the Norwegian coast, and they're hit by anti-aircraft artillery. The plane barely stumbles home. Now, the trouble with all that delay is that Operation Grouse is still there. This looks like a cozy place to spend your winter, doesn't it? After Freshman, Operation Grouse has to escape. There's a manhunt for anyone who was involved in helping the British. So these gentlemen escape up into the Vita, a place, as legend has it, it grows so cold so fast that flames freeze in the fire. They go up to a cabin, a one-room cabin. These four men, they have very little food, they have very little assistance, and now they need to survive the winter alone. They survive basically off of reindeer. They hunt reindeer, they eat only reindeer. They become such connoisseurs of reindeer that they would write about their favorite parts of the reindeer. Does anyone want to know the favorite part of the reindeer? Anybody? Yes. Do you know?
No,
okay. This may be a little gruesome, but there's fat behind the eyelid that apparently is quite delectable. They survive, but they're getting weaker and weaker. Thankfully, in mid-February, Gunnerside finally lands. Now, a lot of things aren't going well. This is another factor. They land, and what the men called the worst blizzard they had ever seen hit. A blizzard so strong that they were literally lifted off of their feet and thrown backwards by the gusts of wind. They housed themselves in a cabin they luckily find. They waited out for 5 days. They emerge in this landscape that looks, as they said, totally transformed by snow. They finally meet together, Operation Gunnerside, Operation Grouse, these 10 men. And I won't forget Schinnerland here. At some points in time, he was staying with Operation Grouse in the cabin. He was providing them batteries for their wireless transmissions. He was skiing constantly back and forth, continuing to provide intelligence. But he is not on this mission. He, in some ways, is too important, much like Knut Haugland, the other radio operator, to go on this. So it's 9 men that are going to participate in Operation Gunnerside. They meet together, they go to a cabin that overlooks Vemork, and they decide how they're going to hit the plant. Now the Germans, as I said, now suspect that the attack is going to come across the lone suspension bridge. Doubly guarded, 2 gates. If they manage to eliminate the guards, there will most certainly be an alert, so they discount that. Secondly, they can come down from the mountains that you see above Vemork. You can see the pipelines, actually, where the water is coming down that feeds the hydroelectric plant. They could come down there. There's actually a stairwell there. The problem is there's minefields littered all over that place. So they decide not to do that. Leif Tronstadt, back in London, was looking at aerial photographs and noticed, of course, there's this valley, and there's some trees that growing up, that maybe you can go down the valley and just climb up and then, you know, make your way down the railway line that hugs the edge of this cliffside and reach the plant. Well, the local boys, this Operation Grouse, which were pretty much all local boys from Rukan, said no. I mean, these are boys whose parents would say, you know, at 10 or 11 years old, we'll go out onto the Vita and have a great 3 days camping, you know. But their parents told them never climb this cliffside. At one point, a car crashes over in their youth, and men have to rappel down with ropes. That's how steep parts of it were. Tronstadt says, maybe you should do this. Haukelid now is there and says, I think that's a great idea. Bonzo's all for it. Ronenberg's not sure, but they have this idea. They go down, they climb up, they go the railway line. This will be the only way they can get in without alerting anybody. So Ronenberg takes a vote. and he wants the men to have to participate in the decision, to be bought in on the decision, and they vote to a man to climb this cliffside. And so on the night of February 27th, 28th, they ski down from their cabin. They take off their skis at some point because it's too steep. They hike down. They almost get mowed over by a bus of German soldiers coming up to the plant. They reach down into the valley, and now they're at the base of this 500-foot cliff that they need to climb. And Ronenberg later recalls saying, Ronenberg later said, it looked like being on a street and looking up at a skyscraper. And that's what he needed to climb. But of course, these Norwegians, they do it. They manage to scramble up this cliffside. They reach the railway line. They move down. They wait till the guard rotation shift. They snap the lock on the gate. They split into two teams, the covering party led by Haukelid, and Ronenberg leads the two-man demolition teams. They reach the plant. They have everything they need to know. They know the door is going to be open. They reach the door, and the door is shut. Thankfully, they had everything they needed to know, as I said earlier, about this plant. They knew that there was this little tunnel that carried pipes into the plant. And so they decided to go up this ladder. They shimmy through this rough concrete tunnel. They drop into the basement level of Vemork, and there's nobody there. The Germans never thought that anyone could possibly get inside, so they left it unguarded. There was a single foreman watching over the heavy water plant. He, although scared, was not putting up any resistance to these men who were coming in British uniforms, saying they were British speaking Norwegian very well. And they set the explosives perfectly. There's an explosion. They're running out. They're throwing themselves down this cliffside, and they're on the run. Now, I in some of these presentations, I like to say that's half the book. That's half the story. There's much more, and it literally is the halfway point of the book, because what they did not expect was that the Germans needed this heavy water so badly that although they destroyed the supply, they destroyed the machinery, within the span of roughly 5 months, they reconstituted the plant. It was producing heavy water again, and not only was Vemork producing heavy water again, but down in Rjukan, there were two hydroelectric facilities that now, two hydrogen facilities that now were being converted to produce heavy water as well. But I will leave you to read the book to figure that out. But what I do want to sort of end with are some themes that come out of this story that I think are important to highlight. The first, as I mentioned with Schennerland, was toughness, how tough they were. And I'll give you one example, Klaus Helberg. Klaus, who was from Rjukan and was part of Operation Grouse, after the gunner side operation, there was an even more massive manhunt. The Germans avoided on the occupation of Norway entering the Vita. They avoided it. They went around it. Now, Heinrich Fehlis, the head of the SS in Norway, is so upset at this that he decides to send an army into the Vita. Many of them not perfectly good skiers, but some of them good ones. Klaus Helberg waits this out in Oslo. A friend writes him a letter from Rjukan saying it's over, you're safe to return. The letter was wrong. Klaus is at one of the cabins where they had buried some explosives. He had his cross-country skis off. He was warming himself in the cabin when he sees out the window three German skiers coming towards him. Now, to reach this cabin, he had already skied roughly 25 miles, and seems like a long distance to me. And he sees them, and he throws on his cross-country skis, and he's off. And he's thinking pretty good about himself because, you know, this is his terrain, and he's an expert cross-country skier, and he distances himself rather quickly from two of them, but there's one Austrian skier who's holding on tight. And they ski for hours. Tough. And what Helberg notices is that when he goes uphill, he gains distance. And when he goes downhill, the Austrian closes the gap. So Klaus decides that he's going to climb every hillock, every mountain, every little bump he can find to get away. And this goes on, and the Austrian won't give up. And so finally, Klaus, having enough, turns, levels his gun, and waits for the German to shoot. His theory is that the setting sun is in his eyes. This Austrian is tired, he's nervous, and he's not going to have very good aim, and Klaus is tired of skiing. So pop, 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 the German misses. Klaus levels one shot, shoots, wounds. The Austrian falls over his skis, and Klaus is off, now quickly, needing to ski because he knows more men are coming, continuing to ski. Klaus skis off a cliff in the middle of the night, 50 feet, 60 feet, he thought, lands, breaks his arm, dislocates his shoulder, gets up, skis another far distance into the morning, one pull to a village. I will leave out the story where he lands himself into a hotel that the Gestapo takes over that evening. The second thing I would raise as a theme is sacrifice. How much these men sacrificed for the war, for what they were doing. Schennerlin, for one, his two brothers were taken by the Gestapo, imprisoned outside of Oslo for almost a year. His best friend was seized, interrogated, tortured over the span of 2 months, trying to find out information about what Einar was doing. But the person I'll bring out here is mostly Haukelid. Haukelid, after this operation, decides he's going to stay in Norway, he's going to build resistance cells, which was essential because of the fact that there would need to be another last-minute sabotage, the sinking of the Hydro ferry carrying the heavy water away. But at one point, Haukelid is in Oslo collecting some forged documents for his budding resistance circle. And Haukelid had been living underground now since the invasion of Norway, so now going on over 3 years. Had not seen his wife, had not seen his parents, had not seen his sister, any family, because it's a bad idea. And he's in this apartment, and there's a knock on the door, and someone comes in, and he hears his father's voice. And there's nothing that Haukelid wants to do more than push open that door, embrace his father, see him, but he can't. It was the last time he would have a chance to see his father. His father was taken by the Gestapo soon afterwards, was imprisoned, and by the time he left prison, he was broken and died soon after. Sacrifice. Haukelid wrote in his Norwegian memoir, for some reason the American or the English edition did not have it, but he wrote a dedication to his father in his memoir. And the dedication read, "He died not knowing why." The last thing I would say as a theme would be teamwork. Now again, much like that story about Skinnerlin jumping through that hole with Elan, which wasn't really the case. You hear and read and see movies about this story, and these gentlemen don't have doubts. They're gung-ho the whole way through. They're bonzos the whole way, when that's not the case. Paulsen recounts, as the head of Operation Grouse, after being in this cabin in the Vita for over 2 months. Now again, remember, this is now winter in Norway. It's probably light only a few hours a day. It's very cold. They're surviving off only reindeer. They only have each other. They're in this cabin. They don't have any electricity. It's dark. And they're going slightly mad in some ways. And Paulsen writes of losing hope, of wondering when Gunnerside is ever going to get there. Is any of this worth it? Why are we putting up with this? Why can't we just go ski down into Rjukan where our families are? And experience in real life those dreams that they were having of platters of food being brought to them to the table. And Paulsen knew that if he didn't do something about it, if he didn't make a change, they were not going to make it through that winter. And the fact is, if they did not make it through that winter, if Operation Grouse did not survive, Gunnerside never would have been a success, never would have happened. So there's this wonderful scene where these four men began telling each other stories to entertain each other, to keep the time going, to sort of build this teamwork that they were in this together. And Klaus recounts of telling terrible poetry. Apparently, he was a terrible poet. And Paulsen, who was a really good hunter, had a family. And on his family wall, they have the 10 Paulsen rules of hunting. And these four guys knew those by the end of the winter. Arne Hjelstrup was a plumber. He dissected plumbing for these guys. By the end of the war, they could fix any toilet, any place with a plumbing problem. But as much as it's kind of funny, it brings to sort of light this idea of teamwork, of how important it was. It's what sustained these guys. It both sustained Grouse and it sustained Gunnerside over critical moments. I'll conclude with two short things. One, there's a lot of, at least historically, was Vemork important? Was this operation important? We know in June of 1942, the Germans decided in a meeting with Albert Speer that they are not going to move forward with the Manhattan Project. And so all the money and all the resources that the Americans threw at this problem, the Germans are not going to do that. And so many say that, yes, this mission was brave because these gentlemen didn't know what the Allies, what the Germans were doing, and that is definitely the case. But what we do also know is at this June meeting, they decide we will continue with atomic research, and Deibner is told, if you manage to produce a self-sustaining reactor, we will shower you with resources. Was it the critical difference, the fact that he didn't have heavy water for that? I would say it's part of the reason that the Germans never attained a heavy reactor and never moved forward with a bomb program. Deibner himself credits at the end of the war, the Norwegian sabotage stopped him from a reactor, stopped him from plutonium, and stopped the bomb program. My opinion is it was part of the reason. I'll conclude with Leif Tronstadt, who finally got his wish to fight, not just in London, but to go into his country, parachute into his country, and lead a small army in the resistance to repel the Germans out. He was killed early in 1945 by a collaborator. He never got to see the freedom of Norway. But I want to bring back the reason these guys were fighting again, because as much, again, as it was about atomic physics and about stopping Hitler's bomb, they were doing it for their towns and their villages. And Tronstadt wrote a letter to his wife that was kept in a safe in London that he gave his secretary the key and said, in the event of my death, I want you to give this to my wife. And Leif Tronstadt Jr. gave me this letter and read it to me. It was in Norwegian. I do not speak Norwegian. But read it to me in Norwegian and translated it for me. And I promised him that I would read it and talk about it when I gave these talks. Dearest Bassa, I have the honor to lead an important expedition home, which will be of great importance to Norway's future. It is in line with the course I chose on April 9, 1940, to put all my effort and ability toward our country's welfare. The war is singing its last verse, and it requires every effort from all who would call themselves men. You will understand that, won't you? We have had so many magical, happy years, and my highest wish is to continue that happy life together. But should the Almighty have another course for me, know that my last thought was of you. Time is short, but if all will not go well, don't feel sorry for me. I am completely happy and thankful for what I have had in life, even though I very much would like to live to help Norway back to its feet. I wish the best for Sitzel and life. I look forward to seeing them all again. And then the letter was signed, Your Beloved. That was Leif Tronstad. Thank you very much.
Let's see, this is an I'll try that one.
Back
that
up.
One? All right. So we've got time for a few questions. If anybody has questions for Neal, I'm sure there must be one or two out there. All right. While you're pondering your questions, I'm going to assert my prerogative then to ask the first one. So these Norwegian commandos were human, not supermen, but pretty remarkable individuals who did something really amazing. After the war, did they go and become plumbers again? I imagine men who are capable of doing this sort of thing and then who do it. I imagine them, going into the military or becoming war correspondents or, something like that. Do you know anything about their sort of post-war lives?
Sure. Some of them continued in the military. For instance, Paulsen did, Haugland did. Ronenberg became a broadcaster. Klaus Helberg was for many seasons a tour guide in the Vita. They all took sort of different courses, but what I would say about their post-war lives are two things. One, these episodes in this life that they lived there sort of imprinted itself on them, sometimes in haunting ways. Einar Schinnerlin's daughter told me that you would never approach Einar from behind because he had lived underground, he had lived in a cabin where at any moment the Germans could come, and he never lost that. Some of them went to sort of heal their wounds by going into the woods for weeks at a time. I think Knut Haugland has the sort of, in some ways, the most extraordinary story, because he himself felt wounded psychologically after all this time. And he decided to join lived quite a life. He joined the Kon-Tiki expedition. He was the radio operator on the Kon-Tiki. So he, lived another extraordinary life, and I think they all did in their own ways. The other thing I would say is they were very tight-knit, most of them, over the course of the rest of their lives. Many of them gathered every year at a hunting cabin in the South and talked war stories, but also just, I think in some ways, nobody else understood them.
Yeah, gentlemen right here in the front row, if you'll hold on 1 second, we've got a microphone coming for C-SPAN.
Thank you so much for your interesting and thoughtful presentation. My name is Abraham Avidor. I happen to serve at the American Embassy in Oslo and recall visiting the underground museum in Akershus. I recall there was a mention of this episode, the bombing of the heavy water facility. And this museum has documented the first act of resistance, which was the sinking of the troop carrier, the Blücher, which sunk 1,500. The German, when they entered the Oslo Fjord on April the 9th, 1940, were not able to catch, they did not have enough force to capture the city, the Oslo, and that enabled the king to escape. So that underground museum was really a major source of inspiration and information about the resistance to the Nazi occupation.
No, I absolutely agree with you. I mean, the Norwegian Resistance Museum was both an absolute resource for me. I mean, their archives are tremendous. And I focus on this story of Vemork, and I talk about the Norwegian independent company, but I think also post-war, to a man, these individuals says their most important job was not Vemork. It was other operations they were on. There were quite a number of company Ling or Norwegian independence men. Many of them lost their lives. They participated in scores of operations. And if you read Leif Tronstad's diaries, Vemork is definitely in there. It's in there, every month or so there's a little mention of it. But there's the litany of other operations. They all were named after, many of them were named after birds. So there's, It's fascinating, the whole story of the Norwegian independent company.
The young gentleman in the third row in from the aisle, we'll take both of them. They both had their hands up.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
What's a mind field?
And if we want to get the one from here as well.
If the Germans kept making the heavy water, why didn't they continue with the bomb program?
So the minefield, first of all, a minefield is basically the Germans and other countries, they put these explosives underneath the ground, okay, and they have a setting that can explode them. And many of them, most of them were taken away after the war, pretty much all of them in the Vemork area, so they're totally safe now. The question about the...
How does it react? Like, explode?
How does it explode? In many circumstances, it's the weight. So let's say an animal is going through a minefield. If a hoof stepped on it, that weight would trigger it to go off. The question of what did they continue to do, because the Germans reconstituted the plant. The Allies, in some ways, got their way. There was a major bombing mission with hundreds of B-17 and B-24 bombers. Exactly what Tronstadt predicted would happen, happened. The plant was not touched. A number of civilians were killed. But the consequence of that, although the heavy water facility was not stopped, the Germans decided at that point, I read a report that one German official sent from Rukan to Berlin saying, the Norwegians have made a national sport, quote unquote, of sabotaging Vemork. We need to move it. And so you find that in February of 1944, they in fact begin to disassemble the plant, begin to bring all the heavy water into barrels. And as I mentioned very briefly, that sets the stage for the last minute sabotage that Knut Haukelid performed to end once and for all the German use of heavy water from Norway.
Other questions? Gentleman back there. We'll come back to you if we get a chance.
Was there any connection or contact between these people and their efforts and Moberg, the American baseball player and linguist who was supposed to survey Werner Heisenberg?
Yes. Yeah, so I love the story of Moberg. Baseball player turned spy. There's a wonderful book called The Catcher is a Spy. I believe that's the title.
Catcher was a spy, yeah.
And his mission, it's one of the reasons I actually turned on to this topic, because I found that so fascinating that Mo would go to Germany, and the plan was if it was clear that Heisenberg was participating in this, potentially to kill him. But he had no contact at all. This was the American OSS handling these operations, and there was a clear demarcation between the SOE and the OSS in terms of Norway and these operations.
Other questions? All right, we'll take one more here, and then we'll call it an evening. Go ahead.
What does heavy water look like?
Ooh, good question.
That's a fantastic question. It looks exactly like regular water. You can't tell the difference. It looks just like this. And in fact, one could argue there's heavy water in a very small quantity in here. There's one molecule for every 41 million molecules of regular water. But it looks the same, and some say it tastes the same, but I don't suggest drinking it. It does, scientists have shown sort of if you drink it in large quantities, change some biological processes, which is one of the reasons they built the plant, is because they thought, one of the heads of Norsk Hydro thought that heavy water would cure cancer. It is not proven to do that, but it looks just the same.
Well, on that note, let me just mention for those of you who didn't see it when we come in, I believe we have back there downstairs, yes, Laura, the nice young lady waving her hand, has a vial of heavy water from Norsk Hydro, which you can look at. Nearby is also some drinks and refreshments, which, as far as I know, do not contain heavy water, but for which we can thank the Norwegian Embassy. Thank you very much. So I hope you will join us at the reception, and let's please all... And the book signing. Thank you. You can get your book signed down there. You can have a drink. You can chat with Neal, chat with our friends from the Norwegian Embassy. Thank you for coming, and have a great evening.
Thank you, everyone.